So I'm Rebecca Struthers, and I'm a co-founding director and watchmaker behind Struthers Watchmakers in the Jewellery Quarter, Birmingham. I work with my husband, Craig. When we first started out our workshop in 2012, we were just vintage and antique restorers. I got married, found a workshop, set it up, and started our first business all in the same month. Craig trained as an illustrator and I'd had a jewellery and silversmithing background, so we were quite creative. And we just heard about this competition called the Lonmin Design Innovation Award. So we decided to enter a watch design where we were going to rebuild the rotor of an automatic. It was a Universal Genève calibre 69 in platinum, and we were going to make it into a pendant. So the whole pendant would wind itself by being a ball mounted into a gimbal that would spin as you wore it. So we entered this drawing thinking we'd never stand a chance, and we won, which was really exciting, until we then realised we had 10 weeks to make this thing. The only non-magnetic platinum alloy is platinum ruthenium, which is also the hardest of all platinum alloys to work with, so no one wanted to work with us. We literally had to teach ourselves case making from scratch, find a way of financing this thing and get the whole thing ready in 10 weeks. And we did it. And yeah, I mean, after we came down from the trauma of the whole experience, we suddenly found ourselves thinking, you know what? We can do this. So we're working on project 248, which is our first in-house movement. And that's inspired by one of these first machine-made Coventry watches from 1880 that we're reverse engineering, but with the benefit of 21st century materials, technology, but still in our workshop that is predominantly 1940s and 50s equipment. We're kind of like the coach builders of the watch industry, so we completely hand build each watch case around each movement, meaning that every case is unique in a way. You couldn't take the bezel off one and just put it onto another. They've all been made to fit and be together. And then the little tweaks that we like to add, so you've got the five knuckle joints that allows for kind of a hinged case back, and we have a hidden movement within the watch. The hinge back is a really nice little tweak for our designs. So it actually came about with a debate, shall we say, between my husband and I. He really didn't like crystal backs on watches. He thought, you know, you'd see that all the time and I don't want to see the movement. I want a really beautifully designed case. Whereas my feeling was is that, yeah, that's because we take watch movements for granted because we're watchmakers. We see them every day. For anyone who's not a watchmaker, the movement is a really special thing.
My name's Heather and I'm studying at the School of Jewellery, doing horology, and I'm an apprentice watchmaker at Struthers London. The apprenticeship with Struthers came about from when Rebecca was watch lecturer at uni last year. After getting to know her, she invited me to become an apprentice here at Struthers London. Struthers is helping me a lot with uni and my degree because they're teaching me a lot more in-depth knowledge of the watches, and including hairspring manipulation and dynamic poison, which is stuff that we learn later on at uni.
Being able to take on our first apprentice from the same place that we trained has been very useful to us. And having a site that's literally over the road from us means that she can kind of pop in a day a week, 2 days a week around her schedule, and it complements her research as well and her study at university. For me, kind of being based in this area is incredibly important. Not only is it important kind of for my family heritage, but for the heritage of the Jewellery Quarter itself. The Jewellery Quarter has been an integral part of British industry since the Industrial Revolution. 40% of the UK's jewellery comes from this one square kilometre of Birmingham. One of the best things about working as a community of makers is the kind of ideas exchange and skill exchange, because a lot of our skills are interchangeable. For example, engine turning, whether it's on a pen or on a watch dial, if one person could do one thing, they can do both. Having people that we can collaborate to make these things as well is just a real privilege to have. And being able to go out and see their workshops, see what they're making, it gives us ideas about what we can start incorporating in our own work. For example, with enamel dial manufacturing. There are no commercial enamel dial manufacturers in the UK anymore. It's something that we used to make thousands of every year, but just the skills have died out. But by having someone like Deakin and Francis on site, who've been enamelling for literally 230 odd years, going downstairs to just have a chat with their enamellers when we come up with something, it's through those conversations really that you stand any chance of reviving these skills in the UK.
No Welcome to Deakin and Francis. My name's Henry Deakin and I am the seventh generation to be lucky enough to be running the Deakin and Francis cufflink empire. We've been making cufflinks since 1786. We've never moved premises, we've never moved buildings, and some of the machinery is still existing from over 100 years ago. And we're one of the very few companies that design it, make it, and sell it as a product here. We're using techniques that go back generations. As you've seen from your tour today, we do not have green and red buttons. Everything is made by hand and made to last. We do a huge amount of vitreous enamelling. Vitreous enamelling is the glass enamelling, so it's the hot enamel. We start by stamping the silver. We use specialist silver because the enamel will hold better to certain types of silver. Once the silver's been stamped and had the back fitting placed on it, we boil the cufflink in acid to make sure there's no fingerprints, no grease, no marks on it, because once you put the enamel over the top, anything will show up. Once you have your enamel disc or cufflink, whatever you're enameling, you start to layer on the enamel. It's a glass powder that gets fired between 500 and 700 degrees. You have to bring up the temperature incredibly slowly. If you bring it up quickly, the enamel will crack. Once it's cooled down after the melting process, you add on the second layer and third layer, and we go up to about 5 layers depending on the item. Once you've had its final firing, we then use volcanic ash to polish off the top surface of the enamel, which gives you the perfectly flawless Deakin & Francis enamel quality cufflink. As you can see, a lot of these machines have been here for a very long time, most of them over 100 years. As a company, Deakin Francis not only make for ourselves, but we make for many other companies, and signet rings are one of our strong spots. We've been making signet rings here as far as we can see records going back. Again, these are all made the traditional ways. You can cast a signet ring, but that's not the look that Deakin Francis would go for. You arrive here with your sheet of metal, your bar of metal, and you use a machine like this one here, which is a fly press, to stamp out the basic shape of the signet ring. Once you've gone through that stage, you then move on to one of the drop stamps using very much old technology of twisted ropes and pulling them down. They force the metal into the dies, creating the shape of the signet ring.
Yard Lead have been making pens and pencils for 85 years. Here in Birmingham, we have been trying to make traditional pens and pencils using the traditional techniques that have been passed down from craftsperson to craftsperson. The guys here in this workshop have been with us 22 years, 17 years. But again, we're thinking about the future. We have taken on new craftspeople, young craftspeople that are very keen to learn these traditional skills. Again, with the engine turning, the chasing, and how we actually make the pens up in general.
So my education up until this point, I first did my GCSEs at high school and then went on to do quite unrelated A-levels really. And then whilst looking at universities, I really thought I wanted to not really be buried in books for the next 3 or 4 years. I ended up coming across Birmingham City University, and that's where I started to do horology. I think as a brand, Yardley is very special because it's all made in England, it's all handmade. It's very personal touches that are added either through engine turning or chasing. And just like the few hands that it does go through are really caring ones, and I think that really stands testament to the company. I think engine turning has been really valuable in horology from people like Brege, who have done incredible. You've got people like George Daniels that also did their own really amazing engine turning. I think it's a great way of getting a great pattern. And you know, the machines are so old and there aren't even that many left of them in circulation. And so I think to have one here as well is really special.
So I'm a recent graduate at the Birmingham School of Jewellery. I studied jewellery design and related products and specialised in silversmithing. So with chasing, we use a series of punches that are all made out of steel. The reason we use steel is because it's harder than the silver and it will leave an imprint in the silver because silver's really soft. And they've all got special cuts on them to do different shapes. You need to put a mandrel inside the silver to support it. So like I said, it's really soft, and if I hit it, it'll just collapse. We put it on a piece of wood, a bit of cloth, and a bit of rope just to hold it, which is weighed down with my foot. And then you're pretty much set to go to start chasing because it won't move. When you're chasing, you rotate the punch around, because you can't get every angle with just one strike. So this is a 19th century technique. Chasing hasn't changed since then really. And it's not really a mass produced technique either. It takes a while to chase.